The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Welcome to today's webinar entitled, What Condition Dataset is Right for You? My name is Billy Zadig, Manager of Special Programs for APA. Just a couple of housekeeping items before we get started. The webinar recording will be posted to the APA webpage under the Continuous Learning tab later today. Professional continuing education certificates are being offered for today's program. Those who indicated they wanted a certificate at registration and meet the requirements will receive certificates later this afternoon. All attendees are in listen-only mode. Please type your questions in the chat box and they will be answered in the order they are received. If we run out of time and we still have questions, responses will be sent directly to the person asking the question by our presenter. At this time, it's my pleasure to turn this over to Bill Roth, our speaker for today. Bill, take it away.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Billy, and thank you all for joining here today for our webinar, Which Condition Assessment Dataset is Right for You? So just real quick, as a way of introduction, I'm Bill Roth, the president and CEO of Roth Island and the co-founder of Slam Technologies. I've got almost 30 years of experience collaborating with higher education institutions across North America on all aspects of facility and infrastructure asset management. And I'm an active member of several industry associations like NASPA, APA, and regional chapters, SERAPA, ARAPA, many others. So thank you all to APA, and thank you all as members of APA for joining us here today. So our agenda is going to focus on three things, three types of data sets: a life cycle model data set, time-limited forecasts, and what we call element-level inventory. So these are sort of the three main types of condition assessment data sets that higher education institutions will look at. And so we'll talk about each of these in greater detail, and some of them, there's some nuance inside of each of these three categories. So we'll start with modeled and life cycle data. So this is really where we look to categorize a portfolio of buildings into building type. This can be based on use or program, construction type, potentially even age, and basically it's categorizing everything. If you've got a campus with, say, 50 to 100 buildings, there's probably 8 to 12 different types of facilities that you're going to have. There might be a lab building, there might be a residence building, an athletics facility. Taking the portfolio and breaking it down into these types. Then, once you have those types, what you want to develop is a high-level list of elements that you would expect to be in a typical building of this type. So you're going to have unit costs and expected useful lives associated with each of those elements that you would expect to see. You want to look at the date of construction and or major renovation of the building to apply against that list of elements, because what you need is you need a date of construction and the expected useful life, and that will allow you to forecast a future capital renewal need based on the date of installation plus the EUL. And then you use the square footage as the baseline for a lot of the costing associated with the elements. So what it allows you to do is create a life cycle model for the theoretical elements that are within a building. And this is why we call it the building type model. This is the sort of highest level data set from a granularity perspective. And you have to recognize some of the limitations of it are that some of the elements that are in a typical building may not be in your exact type of building. The specific building with which you're putting into the category. So that's sort of step one, building type model. Now, the client-informed model is where you basically take your building type model and you collaborate with the end client and with staff that are knowledgeable of each of the individual facilities. So the building types, you drop everything into X number of buckets, you model them out, Now what you're doing is you want to get a better sense of what's actually in the building. It also allows you to potentially take it down to a more granular level where you look at different types of elements. What type of roof is on the building? What type of walls? What type of finishes are located in the building? So it gives you a little bit more robust to your data set, a little bit more of a real world data set. And then you also can adjust based on dates of installation or construction, because if you just look at the baseline date of construction of the building, it's, you know, most likely some elements have been replaced. At that high level model, you're really just focused on, again, data construction and or major renovation. Whereas here, based on information from the client, you can start to get more accurate information about the actual dates of replacement or installation of some of. It does require a little bit more effort on the client side of things. Basically, you're creating a worksheet per building that they can go in and provide comments on and make changes, but it does give you a little bit more accuracy and correctness associated with the data. Our third type of model is what we call a validated model. And so you can either take the building type model or the client informed model, and you do a limited on-site assessment. If you're going to do a validated model, probably would skip over the client informed aspect of it, because your consultant would come out and start to look at adjusting the condition, the replacement values, and providing a condition rating for some of those elements that require attention in the near term. Usually 5 years or so is what a validated model will do. And in some cases, start to gather some photos as it relates to the validated model. So here on the screen, you'll sort of see. So this is sort of, and we just demonstrate the granularity that we're talking about. So here, our building type model, probably go down to uniform at level 2. You get a date of installation, which again would be the original construction date of the building. You're going to get EUL of 35 years, which is sort of a blended EUL for all HVAC, right? Because we're at that higher level, we're at that level 2 of uniform at. The replacement year would be, in our particular case, we're in 2024 right now, because 1967 plus 35 is a lot. I think it's what, 2002. So that HVAC system has been deferred quite a bit. And you're going to get a modeled cost of $2 million just based on the square footage of the building and expectations of the percentage of the replacement value for HVAC. So with the client-informed model, you'll see the main difference is we have an updated date of installation, right? In this particular case, this HVAC system was replaced in 92, and so our actual replacement year has been adjusted 3 years, because this was very seriously deferred in this case, and the cost would be really the main change is that the client provided the information that said it was installed in 92. When we get into the validated model, again, we're still at that high level, at uniform at level 2. We have the updated date of installation, either provided by the client or provided as part of that validated assessment. We're going to get a condition rating because we're on site, and we're going to get some photos of the different elements that make up that HVAC system. So this is just wanted to sort of show for those who say, hey, well, what does a building type model data set look like? What do all these, so really this is just to demonstrate sort of visibly what the data sets could be. Not all validated models include photos, but some do, so I wanted to just provide that as a sample. So if you don't have a condition assessment data set, or your data set is really old and outdated, and you're considering modeling, when do we think that it works best? And it's really if you're just getting started on an asset management program. So if you don't have a data set and you don't have a lot of money or time or resources to invest in getting the data set, it can be a great way to get started. So it requires the least amount of time, and it can give you sort of an order of magnitude of your deferred capital real maintenance backlog. It's sort of a forecast. It's a number that's useful for a forecast, not necessarily to operationalize and provide a detailed ongoing prioritized multi-year capital plan. But if you have no idea what your deferred capital renewal and maintenance backlog is, and you need, hey, what's our order of magnitude? This is a way to get it relatively inexpensively and relatively quickly. It works best where your portfolio has similar building types. The more homogeneity to your portfolio, the better modeling works, because you can get those models to be more accurate to the specific buildings that you're looking at. So, social housing, K-12 schools, oftentimes there are similar types of buildings. It's a little higher and harder in higher education, because there's often you need more templates or building type templates to capture the robustness of a campus, but it's certainly possible to do it. If you have limited resources to manage the data from an ongoing perspective, because this data is at a higher level, that uniform at level 2, maybe even level 1 for things like structure and things like that, your data set is going to be smaller. It's going to be less granular, so there's less ability to operationalize it, but it requires less resources to manage it. And if you don't have or plan to have any asset management software in place, whether that's a work order system or a capital planning system, you can generally manage this data fairly easily on a spreadsheet, simply because it's a higher level. So we talked about when it works, what are some of the limits of the modeling process? And the biggest one is it's not a real world representation of your actual buildings, right? We're trying to get close enough that we can have a fairly decent forecast of future capital renewal needs, but there may be elements in your data set that don't actually exist in the specific buildings. So you just need to understand that and make sure your stakeholders understand that, and make sure that you recognize that if and as you evolve this data set to a more granular level, there may be things that you're actually crossing off or replacing with other things. The data cannot be used as the basis of an actual capital or maintenance plan, simply because it's too high level, right? HVAC covers, it could be 20 or 30 elements within a building, right? Rarely would you replace the HVAC system in a building. You're going to replace boilers, you're going to replace air handling units, you're going to replace elements that are level 3 or uniform at level 4. So that's why we say it's good to use for a financial forecasting perspective, but it's a little bit harder to take to that next level of taking your data set, building a prioritized capital plan, and then potentially even integrating it with, say, a work order system. The other thing is you need to understand the limitations and the reliability of the data when you're talking to your stakeholders. So you never want to present a model data set as a detailed condition assessment data set. It's just simply too high level. There are going to be errors linked into the process, particularly the higher up you go, right? The validated model will be more correct for what's actually in the building. The building type model or the high level model is very much theoretical. So whatever type of model you're using, you want to understand yourselves kind of what it is and what it isn't, as well as make sure that your non-facility stakeholders don't represent it outside the organization or even inside the organization as something that it's not. So that's the model data set. The next one I'll talk about is what we call the time-limited forecast. So pretty straightforward what that is. It's we're looking at basically, this is where you're really focused on gathering more detailed information on what is actually on site. Now, you can do a time-limited forecast built off a model, or you can go to a time-limited forecast kind of from scratch, where you're just either working with a previous data set or, like I said, just coming in brand new with a portfolio. However, you're only gathering information on elements and providing recommendations within a specific time frame. Most time-limited forecasts are either 5 or 10 years. There are some that go to 20, but once you start to get to 20, you're getting pretty close to gathering information on everything within a building, particularly in older buildings. So you gather detailed information on what needs attention and what needs some work, if you will, or capital investment over the next 5 to 10 years, and then there's anecdotal information gathered on the rest of the building. So for example, if you've got a brand new roof on the building, probably be a narrative that says, hey, there's a, you know, there's a brand new roof installed in, you know, whatever, 1990, somewhere buried in a narrative in the report, but your data set, your cost tables are going to be limited to items that require attention within that time limited, hence the time limited forecast, horizon. And you often will capture elements of only those, sorry, photos of those elements within that evaluation period, that 5 to 10 years. So you're getting a detailed data set, but only for items that require attention in a certain period of time. So this is an example of a potential time-limited forecast data set. So here you'll see, instead of just stopping at HVAC, which is level 2, we've got level 3, which is 3040 boiler. We've got a different date of installation, because in our, before we said 92, we were sort of blending the date of installation for the whole HVAC. In this particular instance, this boiler was installed in 88. It has a different EUL, again, because we're down to a more granular level. So now we've got a replacement year and a condition rating and a cost just for the boiler. So instead of having, I think it was $2 million for the HVAC system, we've got a boiler and we're going to have a narrative associated with that boiler. So you'll see here a more detailed data set. In this particular case, we only have one photo. Before, we were looking at the whole HVAC system, so we had photos of several of the different elements. But really, this is a detailed data set around the level 3 element. So it's a more granular data set, and it is more specific just to that boiler, instead of kind of having to homogenize everything at the level of the entire HVAC system. So when do time limited forecasts work best? Well, this still is driven by the private sector more than the public sector, because when you're looking to put financing or you're looking to acquire a building, oftentimes you only really care about, well, if you're financing the building, your lender is going to make you do a condition assessment typically, and its evaluation period is going to be tied to the term of the loan, because the lender wants to know what needs to go in the building over the next number of years in case they have to take it back or to adjust kind of the rate that you're going to get based on needs or loan values. When you go to acquire a building, typically, you know, you're only able to negotiate items within the first 5, maybe 10 years in terms of negotiating a cost reduction. But time-limited forecast is very much driven by the commercial real estate sector. Now, on the institutional side, where we've seen some organizations do it is where you're looking at sort of a first on-site assessment. So maybe you've done some modeling, maybe not. Maybe you just need to know, hey, what do I need to do in the next 5 to 10 years? I'll worry about after that. So let's go out and do our first time assessment. So let's look at a time limited forecast. If you have a limited ownership time horizon of a facility or of a campus, then you probably don't care what happens 20 years from now if you're only planning to own it for the next, you know, 5 to 7 years, and then potentially the best of that asset or a campus in the case of higher ed. This is sort of the in between, right? So we've got the model data, and we're going to get to element level inventory in just a minute. But this is sort of when you want more than model data, but you don't want to pay for a full element level inventory data set. So you begin to gather condition ratings and photos for some elements within the building, but you're only looking at those items in the. So the biggest limit of the time limited forecast is that it has a limited shelf life, because the data set will, we say, rot on the vine. Because if you have a 10-year evaluation this year, next year you only have a 9-year forecast, then an 8-year forecast, then a 7-year forecast. As each year goes, because you haven't got that full element level inventory, your planning window gets smaller and smaller. So it limits your ability to do any longer term facility condition index or forecast of deferred capital renewal maintenance, which tends to lead to shorter term planning. Now, again, if you're just getting started, planning for 5 years or planning for 10 years is better than not planning at all. So it's a nice first step, but you need to understand, again, you want to understand the limitations. Two other points with the time-limited forecast is when you go back to reassess you're essentially starting over from scratch, because ultimately there's a whole bunch of new elements that you didn't really gather detailed information on that are now going to require. Like, so let's say I do assessment today, I come back 5 years later. Now my 10-year evaluation is going to go out 5 years longer. I'm going to have to gather some information on these new elements. So it's kind of like starting from scratch in terms of the cost and effort to do a reassessment. The older the building is, the more items are going to require. The older the building and the more deferred capital renewal and maintenance you have, the more a time-limited forecast is going to be like an element-level inventory. Because in theory, if everything requires attention within the next 10 years, because the building's so old and poorly maintained, it starts to, the differences start the two types of assessments start to blend together. But that's really, you know, the exception to the rule, because there's usually work been done and so on and so forth. The other one is that a lot of organizations use what we call sum of the parts to calculate the current replacement value, which is the denominator of the facility condition assessment, a facility condition index calculation. And so if you only have data on part of the building, you can't use the sum of the parts methodology to calculate the CRV. It's not a huge issue, but it is a limitation, because with that element level inventory, you can, if you've got all of the elements, if you sum up the element replacement cost for all of the elements in the building, then you can get a relatively accurate current replacement value. In this particular case, we only have a partial data set to work from. So last but not least, we're coming to the element level inventory. So this is our most detailed assessment, most detailed data set within a facility. And this is really where you're going to go out and you're going to gather information on all the elements in the building, regardless of the remaining useful life or how many years into the future a recommendation is going to be made to replace it. You're going to capture photographs of everything. And oftentimes organizations will also gather make, model, and serial number and different things like that on some more of the mechanical, electrical equipment, because you're taking a deeper dive. This we're typically going down to unit format level 3, in a lot of cases level 4. So you're going to get a lot more detailed, granular information. By doing an element level inventory as well, you can start to look at cyclical. And so just to define what a cyclical renewal is if I do a 30-year forecast of a facility, and let's say I have carpet in that facility, and that carpet needs to be. Well, if I do a 30-year forecast, carpet expected useful life is 10 years, I, in theory, will have to replace that carpet in 5 years, in 15 years, and in 25 years within that 30-year evaluation period. Because I have gathered that information on all of those elements, it allows me to decide whether I include that cyclical renewal or multiple replacements of those elements is shorter than the evaluation period. So, our reporting period or a forecast period. And so it just gives you the ability to be a little bit more detailed and a little bit more sophisticated in your forecasting and your communication of your future needs. And really, this is the most advanced condition data set that you can get. If you were to go to an equipment inventory, that would be one level more granular, where you're looking at individual pieces of equipment. Again, if there's 3 boilers in the building, you might have information on boiler number 1, information on boiler number 2, information on boiler number 3. You're going to slap a tag on it. You're going to link it up to your work order system. For condition assessments, if all 3 of those boilers were the same age, the same condition, the same type and capacity, you would likely bundle those together into an element called boilers quantity 3, as an example, or quantity of the total capacity of the 3 boilers together. But from a condition assessment data set, as I say, this is the most granular. Going to an equipment inventory would take it one level down, but that is really about work order management, preventative maintenance planning, or O&M instead of capital planning, where what we're talking about here is really for capital renewal forecasting. So this is an example of an element level inventory. So you see we're going down to unit format level 4. So right, we started with HVAC, D30. HVAC, then we went to D3020 boilers. Now we're down to D3020O2, which is a hot water boiler. We have our date of installation, our EOL, our replacement year. Those are all the same. You're going to get a quantity, in this particular case, 625.5 MBH. You're going to get a condition rating. This is just an example of where we're going to gather up the make, the model, and the serial number. And you're going to get a unit cost and a recommendation cost based on that quantity, right? So 625.5 MBH times $115 per MBH comes out at $71,933. You're going to get a description narrative, a condition narrative, some photos, including, again, if we're gathering that make, model, and serial number, you know, we'll grab a photo of the nameplate if it's available. And so that you've got not only the overview of the boiler itself, but also the nameplate. So when does an element level inventory work best? Well, really, it's if you're starting from scratch, can you do it? Absolutely. But the most successful organizations are where you have a relatively mature facility and asset management system or program in place, where you're really looking to plan for the entire life cycle of the building and or your portfolio. So the data set is pretty granular. It's a much bigger, more robust data set. So you need to make sure that you've got the resources in place to be able to use the data, to be able to manage the data, because you're able to do longer term FCI trends, right? If you're managing a campus, you know, 5-10 years, sure, that's a nice tactical window for planning. But from a strategic perspective, hey, what does this campus look like in 20 years, in 30 years? Those longer term views are available to you with the element level inventory, because you have really what is an unlimited forecasting. Because if you've gathered the life cycle of everything within the building, and you also have the ability to apply cyclical renewals, you could do a 100-year forecast. You could do a 200-year forecast if you really wanted to. That's a bit long. Most of us are going to be retired or long gone by that time. But certainly a 50-year forecast is not unheard of within an institutional environment. So you're able to do that longer-term forecasting. Obviously, the future is really purely life cycle-based, because the best mechanical engineer in the world can't look at a boiler and go, I think that's going to last 21 years, not 23 years. So we're going to default to life cycle for those longer term, but at least you have the information that allows you to do that longer term forecast. One of the other big benefits of this detailed data set is it allows you to more easily integrate with your operations and maintenance planning and CNMS integration. As I said, a full element level inventory with barcoding is going to typically be one layer down, and I wouldn't call that a condition data set. I would call that an equipment inventory. However, you've got information on all the elements, so you can kind of reverse engineer oftentimes your work order or CNMS data set from your condition assessment data set. For example, if you know how many boilers there are based on the counts and things like that, you can start to create those pieces of equipment in your work order system, even though you didn't gather necessarily all the information. And again, as I said, the time limited forecast doesn't really allow you to use the sum of the parts methodology for CRV calculation. But once you have a cost or the element replacement cost that represents all of the elements in the building, then you can start to use the sum of the parts methodology. When does it work best? Plan over a longer period of time, whether you need or want to plan over a longer period of time, because you can, like I said, in theory, plan for an unlimited perspective, or unlimited time frame. And if you're going to do regular reassessments, so if you want to do assessments on a 5-year cycle, if you're planning to do that, if you gather that element level inventory the first time, and you keep the data up to date in between the assessments, then the reassessments will cost less, because the effort required will be less, because you've captured everything, you've updated it and evolved it based on what gets done, and then you're just really coming back and re-looking at it and moving some things around within a timeline perspective based on the observed conditions, any new issues that have come up. And you know, if you don't keep the data up to date, you lose a lot of those efficiencies, because people have to kind of come in and forensically figure, oh, look, they were, you know, the roof used to be 92. This is a brand new roof. What year was it installed in? So if you don't keep the data up to date, you can lose some of that efficiency around the reassessments. But if you do keep the data up to date, which we recommend everybody does between assessments, then it can become a pretty straightforward process. The other one is it works best when you have the resources and the sophistication and the tools to manage the data set. If you've got a college or university campus that's large and you do an element level inventory, you're probably going to break Excel. Excel is a great tool, but eventually the data sets just get too big that you're not able to manage it and work with it effectively. Plus, updating the data when you do replacements can be a fairly manual process. And the more data you have, the more updates you're going to need to make as you do the renewal programs. So you want to make sure, if you're going to do this, that you understand the scale of the data set that you're going to receive and the resources that are required to keep that data set up to date as you move forward. So what are the limits of the ELI? Well, it is the highest cost scope of work, right? It's the most granular scope of work, and it's obviously the costs associated with gathering that information, particularly the first time through, are the highest, right? From the modeling through the time limited forecast through the element level inventory, it costs the most. It does require significant input from knowledgeable stakeholders, right? We're dealing with the buildings at a very granular level, trying to get dates of installation and other information and maintenance information and performance information on all of these detailed elements and detailed pieces of equipment. And that does take a little bit more time on the client side in terms of the gathering that information. However, we do feel that for the right customer that does understand the granularity of the data set and the resources that it's going to take to be maintained over time, that the investment is, at the end of the day, as you evolve your asset management plan, is going to be worth it, because it's going to be able to integrate with your work order system. It's going to be able to be operationalized. You're going to be able to develop prioritized multi-year capital plans over the long-term horizon. You're never going to have a declining forecast period or planning horizon as you would in the time-limited forecast. So there is cost associated with not only the acquisition, but also the maintenance of the data set. However, it's going to be the most valuable data set, we feel, for organizations in the long run. So if we look at this, and this is not exactly 100% accurate, folks, this is really just meant to be a relative representation of the granularity of data on the vertical axis and the effort and cost associated with the gathering of the data sets on the horizontal axis. So to do a building type model, this is really a desktop exercise, and it is relatively inexpensive. It can be as little as 10% of the cost of a full element level inventory. It also can be done fairly quickly. The most difficult or time consuming part of the building type model is getting those building types set up and getting the templates set up. Once the templates are set up, then those templates can fairly easily be applied to one building, 10 buildings, or 100 buildings. It's just getting those templates set up is the lion's share of the work. The rest of it is just computers, whether that's Excel or whatever, churning away at creating these lifecycle elements based on, again, that data construction, expected useful life, and then the unit costing or the percentage of the CRV of the facility. So quick, easy, but high level. The next one, the client-informed model, this requires more effort. The majority of this effort is actually going to be on your side of things, right? Because, yes, if we were working with you, we would have to create the tools and the spreadsheets to get your feedback for each of the facilities. But ultimately, it's going through, building by building and updating dates of construction, different types, things like that. So the majority of the extra time between the building type model and the client form model is going to be your time. So obviously there's costs associated with that as well, because you're paying for your staff, but it's not the same as if you were getting a third party to come and do that. So the validated model, again, just as a reminder, this is where we're sending staff to the site to just validate a couple of the key elements within the building or certain things that need attention in the next number of years. So this is where, once you have to mobilize to site, there's obviously the cost of mobilizing the site, there's time to walk around the site. And so, you know, kind of that 20 to 50% effort or cost compared to the full element level inventory is kind of what we're looking at. So the time limited forecast, again, going to be gathering more information, maybe starting from scratch as opposed, compared to a validated model. And so that's going to be about 50 to 75% of your effort. And the granularity of data, again, it's going to depend to some extent on how old the elements are in the building. Because again, if everything requires attention in 10 years, essentially a time limited forecast and an element level inventory are going to be the same thing. But in most cases, not everything is at or exceeded its useful life. Certain things can be replaced over time. And so it's going to require less effort to gather that 5-10 year time horizon. The longer your time horizon, the closer it gets to element level inventory. Right? If you're going to do a 20 or 25 year time horizon, it's probably the same thing as an element level inventory for most buildings. And then the element level inventory, that's really where we take it to that next step where we're going to take it to the greatest amount of effort, the greatest amount of cost. But it's also, you know, significantly more granularity of the data set. Again, typically in a format level 4, time limited forecasts are usually done to level 3. The models can be done to level 1 or 2. Client informed model you may take to a level 3, but really the majority of modeling is at level 1 or level 2. So really deciding on which data set is best for you is really about deciding and balancing cost against granularity of data, as well as your capacity to manage that data. So what we've done, folks, is we've created a supplemental document. Those screenshots of the data set that we've shown in the presentation, we have a two-page, it's one-page, two-sided PDF that will give you a little bit more details on the specific data set, as well as that picture or that view of what the data set would look like. So if you're interested in that, and Billy, I can provide a copy as well to you if you want to post it on the website along with the presentation, or if you want to email us at info@rothims.com and ask us for which data set supplemental, we'd be happy to send that to you to basically give you a little bit more of a takeaway to support the information that we shared here today. So folks, I wanted to leave some time for questions, so I will open it up for questions here. Doesn't look like there's any questions in the chat, Billy. Can I ask a question and see if some people will put some answers in the chat? So I guess if I could, I'd just be interested, just if I could get a sense of, for those that have a condition assessment data set, who has a model data set, who has a time-limited forecast, who has an element level inventory, and who has none. I'd just be curious if people could maybe type a few notes in the chat. I'm just curious at the breakdown across the group, if that's possible. I'm not seeing anything in the chat here, Billy, so I don't know if... Oh, sorry, I think Billy's having some problems here. Well, folks, while we wait for Billy...